Let's go ahead and try a one-dimensional problem for Newton's second law. Suppose I asked you, if you accelerate a big 1,000-kilogram spaceship, but you only applied 1 newton of force, which, by the way, is approximately the weight of an apple, ironically enough. It's a very small force. And that object, the spaceship, was starting from rest in space. Starting from rest meaning it has no initial velocity, and we put it in space just so we know there's no gravity or anything else that we have to worry about. Just a force on an object. The question is, how far will the spaceship go in 30 days? So in about a month's time, with a tiny amount of force acting on it. So first, pause, see if you can solve this. See if you can find out how far the spaceship has traveled in 30 days with a tiny, tiny force acting on it. Now, if you've solved this problem, you can see an example of how to do so here. So we're going to run through this very quickly with an object moving under the influence of a very tiny force of 1 newton. The first thing that we want to do is recognize that if we're going to do an equations of motion type analysis, that we could write down an equation of motion. For example, this one, for the motion of an object under some acceleration. The problem, of course, in this problem is that we're not given an acceleration. So if you look at this equation of motion, the distance, the final position minus the initial position, which will be exactly this distance here, where you see x and x0, is equal to the initial velocity times the time, where the initial velocity is 0, so we can get rid of that term, plus 1/2 the acceleration times the time squared. So we're already almost done with this problem. We need to put in the time, which we know is 30 days, and we also need to put in the acceleration, so we have to find that one still. The time is not so bad. We have 30 days, and the first thing we have to do here is some unit analysis, because we do want all of our units to be in our standard units, our kilograms, our meters, and our seconds. And so we need to get days converted into seconds. So this is a great practice in unit analysis, which I recommend you try doing first before you see me do it here. To convert the units of days into seconds, we'll keep multiplying by what are essentially units of one. In other words, there are 24 hours in 1 day. So this term here is actually just the number 1, because 24 hours and 1 day are the same thing. So I'm not changing the number 30 days. This is a way to convert its units by not changing the number, but multiplying it by different sorts of the number 1. So we multiply by 24 hours per 1 day. We can multiply by 60 minutes in 1 hour. And then we can multiply by 60 seconds in 1 minute. And the reason this works so well is that I cancel days, I cancel my units of hours, I cancel my units of minutes, so that if I take 30 times 24 times 60 times 60, I will have my time in units of seconds. So if we do this, and you can do this on your own using a calculator or anything else we have, something that is approximately 2.6 times 10 to the sixth seconds. So that's a lot of seconds. So even though we're applying a small force, we do get a long time over which this force is applied. So maybe we'll get the spaceship to move pretty well after all. So let's see. The second thing we have to do is find the acceleration. Here's where we're going to need to apply Newton's second law. We know that F, the force on our object, which is 1 newton, is equal to the mass of the object times its acceleration. So we can find the acceleration quite easily. We just take the force and divide by the mass. In our case, our force is 1 newton. And our mass is 1,000 kilograms. Remembering our units of newtons, what we have is kilograms meters per second squared divided by kilograms. So this is equal to 1 divided by 1,000, which is 10 to the minus 3, using our scientific notation, meters per second squared, which are the units for acceleration. So now that we have these two things, our acceleration from this sort of analysis and our time from this unit analysis, we can plug in and find the distance or the change in position of our object. Doing that, we now have the change in position, x minus x0, where the initial position is 0, equals 1/2 times the acceleration, 10 to the minus 3, times the time, which is this complicated expression, 2.6 times 10 to the 6 seconds, squared. So we have to do one last thing here, which is to square this quantity, 2.6 times 10 to the 6. So this is 1/2 times 10 to the minus 3. And 2.6, when you square it, is approximately 6.76, But as I've already discussed, sometimes you're going to want to just make some approximations on your own to work through a problem very quickly. So for example, in this problem, we could have taken this 2.6 and just tried to put in 3, because we know very quickly 3 squared is 9. So just by doing something very quickly and simply, we can sometimes simplify our analysis and find out what the correct answer, in an exam setting especially, could be without having to deal with any tricky numbers like these ones. So this 6.76 times, and then we have 10 to the 6 squared, which will be 10 to the 12, since we multiply these exponents. Now we do what we've always done with our unit analysis, which is to treat our coefficients, as we call them, the numbers in front, on their own. So we have 6.76, and then divided by 2. And then we treat the powers of 10 on their own. So 10 to the 12 times 10 to the minus 3 subtracts 3 from 12, giving us times 10 to the 9. Then all we have to do is simplify this slightly and get 6.76 divided by 2, which is about 3.38 times 10 to the 9th power, and this is in meters. So 3 times 10 to the 9th, or changing our units, it'll be 3.38 times 10 to the 6th kilometers if we wanted to write it in kilometers. Either one of these would be fine, so be careful in an exam setting to find out which options have meters and which ones have kilometers, and make sure you get your powers of 10 correct. And so we see just from this simple example that even a tiny force, if applied over a long enough period of time, these accelerations will build up more and more and more until you in fact get great distances from very, very small forces. The equations of motion, which we just used in this problem, are often referred to simply as kinematics, how things move. On the other hand, forces, and when we have things under the influence of different forces, we call dynamics, because things are dynamic, they're moving. In the problem we just saw, we saw that the link between these two and the way to solve each one was acceleration. We wanted something to do with the equations of motion, but we didn't know the acceleration, so we appealed to Newton's second law, F equals ma, to find what the acceleration was and to plug that acceleration into the equations of motion. In some problems, you will know the forces and be able to solve for the acceleration, as we just did, and put that into the equations of motion. In other problems, it'll be exactly the opposite. You will know how something moves or be told how something moves, and you will need to deduce the forces on those objects based on the equations of motion going to the dynamics, using, again, the link of acceleration. So be aware that this is very common for problems, that you're able to find the acceleration and use the acceleration to solve for the other, either the dynamics or the kinematics, the equations of motion, or Newton's second law, using the acceleration.